Welcome to the 27th meeting in 2024 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to remind everyone to please switch off or put to silent the mobile phones and other electronic devices. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yep.
Under agenda item number 2, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act 2022 Extension of Temporary Justice Measures Regulations 2024, the draft Upper Tribunal for Scotland Bus Registration and Appeals Composition Regulations 2024, the draft Upper Tribunal for Scotland Transfer of Functions of the Transport Tribunal Regulations 2024, the draft Town and Country Planning Amendment of National Planning Framework Scotland Regulations 2024, and the draft Master Plan Consent Area Scheme, Environmental Impact Assessment, Scotland Regulations 2024. Is the committee content with these instruments?
Yes.
Under agenda item number 3, we're considering instruments subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2024, 246, 247, 248, 250 and 253. Is the committee content with these instruments?
Yes.
In relation to SSI 2024-250, does the committee welcome that the instrument fulfils a commitment by the Scottish Government to correct a cross-referencing error in Regulation 25 of SSI 2023-101, and that was the Town and Country Planning, Development Planning, Scotland Regulations 2023. Under agenda item number 4, we're considering an instrument not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2024-252. Is the committee content with this instrument? Under agenda item number 5, we're taking evidence from Jamie Hepburn, MSP, the Minister for Parliamentary Business. This is one of our regular sessions with the Minister on the Scottish Government's work relevant to this committee. The Minister is accompanied by three Scottish Government officials: Nicola Wisdall, the LCM and Subordinate Legislation Programme Team Leader, Stephen McGregor, the Head of Parliament and Legislation Unit, and Douglas Kerr, the Deputy Legislation Coordinator in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting this morning. First of all, I want to remind you all also not to worry about turning on the microphones during the session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. So I'd like to invite the Minister to make some opening remarks. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to you, and thank you for your invitation to be with you this morning. I'm very pleased to be able to join with you for what is my first public appearance before the committee and to be able to discuss matters within your committee's remit. My predecessor joined you in March. Since then, there has been limited parliamentary time due to summer recess, but I'm very grateful to you, Convener, to colleagues on the committee for your work in considering a number of instruments since I took on the role as Minister for Parliamentary Business. In addition to secondary legislation, I would highlight that we've introduced the long-awaited Judicial Factors Bill, which I know that you, in particular, Convener, were keen to see it progressed. I welcome the very steady progress we continue to make with implementing Scottish Law Commission reports. We continue to strive to bring forward the best quality legislation we can and always seek to maintain high standards in drafting. I know my officials and your committee clerks continue to work closely together, and I remain committed to listening carefully to the views of the committee and do my best to resolve any issues which arise. I look forward to engaging with you today, and I'm very happy to take any questions, as to the best of my ability, with the assistance of Stephen, Nicola and Douglas.
Thank you very much, Minister. And as you said, this is your first public appearance in front of this committee, so we do look forward to working with you in the months ahead. So whilst the vast majority of SSIs are not reported under any reporting grounds by the committee, we continue to identify some drafting issues, including a rise in minor points. So can you tell the committee what you're doing, Minister, to try to ensure that the quality of SSIs remains high?
Well, I would go back to the point I made in my opening remarks, Convener. That would always be our ambition. We want to try and get it right first time, but of course I recognise that on occasion that won't be the case, and where that's identified, of course we will put that right in the specific case, but we also seek to learn from that experience. Of course, quality of any instrument that we take forward is the responsibility of all those involved in taking it forward, from either a policy perspective or those involved in legal drafting. From the perspective of the SSI programme, there is the provision of training to specific teams. We believe that bolsters the central provision of information and guidance. PLU are always there to try and make sure that any teams taking forward a SSI is as high quality as it can be, and that training should assist that process. Various officials are available to support policy leads bringing forward secondary legislation. Government lawyers are also provided with the support they would require, the training they would require, the guidance they would require in considering any proposals for an SSI, any of the legal issues that might arise, and of course of the drafting issues they should be aware of. This includes a monthly session for lawyers to share knowledge about SSIs. And then in relation to any specific SSI, once is drafted, it then is checked with within the team that drafted the instrument. They have to go over it to make sure it's in the correct place. But then also, so that there's outside assessment, then there's a further check by another lawyer not directly involved in that drafting. So there is the chance for some other form of input for the identification of any issues. So hopefully that's an indication that not only do we take the issue seriously, we would always seek to get it right in the first place, but we continue to try and make sure that those involved in the process are upskilled, aware of what they need to do, and there's also the wider support to enable them to do that.
Okay, no, thank you there for that, Minister. Certainly in the last session in March, the committee highlighted that four instruments had been reported under the more serious grounds, and since that session the committee has also reported another two instruments under one of the more serious reporting grounds. Both were under the ground I, which is the drafting appears to be defective. So you've just indicated a moment ago there in terms of the various processes that are in place when it comes to the instruments coming through the process, including the external eyes upon the instruments. Are there any other steps that the government could take to try to ensure that the quality of the SSIs does remain high, and that the situation regarding the more serious issues are reduced?
So I suppose I would obviously refer back to the answer I've just given on a general basis, but the fact that there are some identified speaks to the point that we won't always get it right, and what we seek to do is, where those are identified, try and put in the remedial action that is necessary to deal with the specific instruments. I think, you can correct me if I'm wrong, Convener, that the two instruments you might be referring to are the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2024 and the Evaluation Proposals Procedure Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. Hopefully I've got those correct and can speak to them specifically. In relation to the former, we plan to rectify the defective drafting by including amendment provision within the next Scottish Immunities and Privileges Order. And now, the timing of that, of course, depends on the progress of two UK orders. That's not entirely in our hands, of course, and it would also require equivalent Scottish orders, which are, of course, more in our hands, but still reliant on the process at a UK level too. And of course, we would seek to keep the committee updated. On the latter, the Evaluation Proposals Procedure Amendment Regulations, although the issues that have been identified have no bearing on the validity of the instrument, we intend to bring forward amending regulations at the next suitable opportunity, taking into consideration any other amendments that may potentially be required, and we would seek to do that in advance of the intended cut-off date for making a proposal in reliance on the relevant part of the 1975 Act. So And I think that date is effectively the end of this parliamentary year, so the end of March. Oh, no, I beg your pardon. No, the end of the parliamentary session, end of March 2026. So hopefully there's an indication that in relation to the respective orders that you identify, we're aware of them. We are cognisant of the need to rectify them. And in relation to the general process, I would go back to my initial answer. We are, of course, always open to hearing other things that we could do with the committee's experience as such that you feel there are additional steps, additional measures that we could take to quality assure our process, then we'll be more than happy to hear what they might be.
Okay. No, thank you for that, Minister. Tim Eagle.
Minister, thank you for coming in this morning. Just to pick up on that point for clarity, I guess, around the SSSIs, because there has been those five now reported under the most serious reporting ground. And I guess my slight concern would be that we are seeing more secondary legislation, particularly around framework bills, coming in. So actually moving forward, I guess, are you confident then that you are reviewing that to say, you know, moving forward, we've got the processes in place that ensure that actually that number will drop over the subsequent months? Because I was reading back to the report in March, the official report, and Stuart McMillan asked the same question, you know, what are you doing to ensure the quality of SSIs remains strong? And the answer you've given today is almost identical to what the Minister gave on that day. And I guess there's no point in seeing every 6 months just the same answer coming forward. So actually, given the fact there might be more secondary legislation, more SSSIs, are you actually going to have some sort of review to check that actually we are not going to see that number increasing any further?
I'm sure I must have answered it with more panache and elan than the previous
I'm sure you did.
Of this office. In relation to, I think the point you're making is, you know, what can I say, what can assurance can I give in relation to there not being more? In terms of the whole programme, that's determined by what is required. The fundamental point I suppose you make, Ms. Regal, is what can we do to ensure that the number of those that you identify where there are serious issues is reduced. I can only go back to the point I've made before, that we have a process in place. I recognise that it will not always suffice, it will not always work. Things do go wrong. To err is to be human. People and humans are involved in the process. And I guess that's why I would make the point, that's the purpose of parliamentary scrutiny. If this committee identifies anything that's defective, anything that things need to be improved in, it's incumbent on us to take that away and make those improvements. All I can stress is that I understand the necessity of making sure that they are as high quality as possible. If I get any sense that there is slippage in that, then I will use the power of my office to make sure that we're across government emphasising the need, the requirement for SSIs to be of a high quality, because I don't want, I think we all recognise that it will on occasion happen, but I don't want it to be a regular occurrence. I don't want it to be a feature of the system. I want to be hearing from the committee that the numbers are greatly reduced. So that's where I want to land. And again, I go back to the point I've made. If there are things that the committee think could further improve and refine the process, and I'm more than willing to hear what they might be.
Thanks.
Thank you. Jeremy Buffer.
Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your team. Sorry, excuse me. Your officials helpfully provide the committee and subject committees with weekly updates of instruments expected to be laid in the following 2 weeks. I wonder if you can provide an indication of any anticipated volume of SSIs likely to be laid between now and Christmas, and the expected lead committees that they will go to?
Yes, I think I have that information in here. First of all, I would say we will always make sure that we continue that process that you've referred to, Mr. Balfour. My expectation is that we provide that regularity of update in terms of the instruments to be laid, because I appreciate that there is limited time for committees, so they need to be able to factor that in. Volumes right now look fairly steady. We think from this period, from this week until Christmas, there should be around 50 instruments in that period. It may not surprise you that this committee is uppermost amongst those who will have more than others, but also net zero, local government and health will have around about 8. The others are split roughly fairly evenly, but 5 for the rural affairs, social justice and education committees, and maybe less than 5 for the others. But you know, of course we will continue to look at that, make sure that we think we're in the right place with that, and keep this committee and all committees updated as to their expected caseload, for want of a better term.
Thank you, Minister. I mean, given that some of the SSIs are much longer, more complex than others, it's particularly useful for this committee, as well as subject committees, to be given as much advance notice as possible of large and complex instruments. Do you know if there's any such instruments or sets of instruments in the pipeline? And if not, will you commit to keep committees and ourselves up to date as to progress?
Well, on the latter, you can assure that that's a given. You know, we will make sure that we do that just as I've laid out. I would always, it would be my request of my officials to make sure that, because I recognise it's not just I've talked about the caseload, it's not just the number of instruments that are going to bring press to bear in committees, it's their complexity, it is their length, some by nature of what they seek to do will be longer than others. I can say on that basis there will be some that will be fairly not long. I think there'll be one that will be particularly long, but what we would seek to do is just make sure that committees have that in advance notice as much as is humanly possible. Now, I suppose I go back to the point I made in the initial answer. All of these are subject to refinement, so what might be at the outset particularly long may by the end of that process not be quite as long, so we will go through that internal process, and the finalised instrument will come out at the other end. But whilst I can't give specific details right now, I can give an early indication there probably are likely to be some that will be fairly substantial.
And are we likely, just to push you slightly, Mr, are we likely to come to this committee or to other committees?
I think it will be across the range. Some may come to this committee. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for your answers, Minister, so far. Now, this is wordy and complex, so I'm going to read most of it. But moving on, if we can, to the Scottish Government's historic commitments in relation to SSIs. You'll be aware that on a number of occasions the Committee has requested an update on the amendment to the Scotland Act 1998 and specifications of functions and transfer of property. At the last session, the then Minister said that although the work is really complicated and quite difficult for the officials to get sorted, they're in the process of fixing it and getting it sorted. So can you give us an update on the progress on this commitment to resolving issues over the Scotland Act 1998?
Well, without doing as it was suggested before, I would re-emphasise the point that my predecessor made. This is obviously complicated, and there are some complexities involved, but I'm conscious that it does need to be resolved. Official level engagement continues to take place to progress an amendment to correct the drafting errors that were identified in the Scotland Act 1998, the specification of functions and transfer of property order. We continue to take work to address those issues. We think it should be complete by next year. I reckon that's still a very long period of time, but again, I would make the point that my expectation is that work is done and we are able to complete it as soon as possible.
It is being worked on anyway, sort of thing, and continuing towards that, and hopefully next year, as you say, is when we can look to.
That's certainly when I hope it will be sort of BS work continues.
That'll be great, because we'll be seeing you again. So that's good.
I hope, I don't know when you'll invite me, but hopefully by that stage, depending on when it is in 2025, I'll be able to see where we're further down the line.
That's really good stuff to hear. Thank you. Now, in addition to that commitment, which is ongoing, there are seven other outstanding commitments which the Scottish Government has made to the committee. Five dating from 2023 and two from 2024. Now, of those seven, what is being done to ensure that all of these commitments are also being met, please?
Well, so I'm aware that last time there was more identified, and we have worked our way through them. I suppose when we refer to five, quite a lot of them, those commitments largely relate to the similar area. So in relation to the provision of pensions. So hopefully we can work through them simultaneously as much as possible. And if we're able to deal with them timeously, then that should reduce the number quite significantly. One of the commitments, I think, that was outstanding was also related to the budget. Scotland Act 2023, I suppose I would make the point that the Budget Scotland Act 2023 is now superseded by the Budget Scotland Act 2024. So I think I should say we do not intend to deal with the issue identified in the Budget Scotland Act 2023, but I would concede that the issue still remains in terms of the drafting error. So we are due to publish the Budget Scotland Act 2024 Amendment Regulations 2024, which is the equivalent SSI for the current financial year. That should be done next week, and that will resolve the issue of the pluralisation of the word programme. It should be programme singular, and it will resolve that then.
Thank you. And obviously then from that, lessons will have been learned from the 2023 and brought forward for 2024 going ahead again then. So really, that will have been resolved in its own way.
Yeah, well, that should be resolved by that order. The key thing is that when we come to the next budget, that we don't revert back and make the same error then.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Daniel Johnson.
Thank you for unmuting me. The Minister will be relieved to hear that the committee requires me to ask my questions from a cupboard in an undisclosed location. But can I ask about legislation relating to reports from the Scottish Law Commission? Indeed, the Minister made reference to that in his opening remarks regarding the Judicial Factors Scotland Bill. As you'll also be aware, in the programme for government, the government set out its intention to bring forward a bill relating to the new leases automatic continuation bill. So I just wanted to ask what the timescales were for the introduction of that bill, and also what was the basis of decision-making in terms of choosing that report to bring forward that bill?
Well, I think the first thing is we'd all be delighted to know the undisclosed location, but that's up to Mr Johnson as to whether or not he'll disclose that information to us. In relation to the bill that we've committed to, introducing the leases automatic continuation, etc. Bill, I don't have a specific date for the committee just now. That is as ever contingent on the progression of the rest of our legislative programme. What I can say is that I hope it will be a nice festive gift for the committee, but I make no promises in relation to whether or not that comes to pass. My expectation is that bill should come to this committee in relation to the agreement that was made when standing orders were changed to enable this committee to consider Scottish Law Commission bills. And on relation to the question as to why this bill, partly candidly, it's on the basis of this bill is more ready to be brought forward than some others. So that being the case, why wait? You know, bring it forward and let's get it done, but it's also something that we've identified as being in line with the wider ambitions of the government in relation to the hopes and aspirations we have for the economy, for example. So it neatly ties into to that as well. But you know, as with all these things, you know, there's a backlog. We need to work through them, and if some are readier to go than others, then let's bring them forward.
Well, I thank the Minister for that answer, and I guess we have all the more reason to look forward to Christmas now. I just wondered if he was able to elaborate on the degree to which it meets the criteria set out, or the objectives set out in the Scottish Law Commission report.
Well, I should, of course, say there are many festivals across the year, so I didn't pledge which one, so that gives me some leeway and discretion, hopefully, convener. I mean, it's in terms of it meeting the criteria that we've identified. I suppose it goes back to the answer I've just given a few moments ago. It takes forward the Scottish Law Commission recommendations to improve, simplify, update aspects of the law of commercial leases. We think that makes the necessary contribution to ensuring we have a modern and effective statute book. So I think that fulfils the criteria, the broad criteria that we have for bringing forward Scottish Law Commission bills for this committee to consider.
Again, I thank the Minister for that answer. Can I also just ask, in terms of the other legislation that the Scottish Law Commission is looking at, I take a great deal of interest in the Tenements Maintenance Bill and the proposed legislation reform of the law that the Law Commission has been looking at. I was just wondering if the government had any view as to when it might look to bring forward a bill in that area.
It would be... clearly, we have a commitment to bring forward one a year. That's the process we've agreed just now. I cannot, it would be disingenuous of me to say I can give a specific timescale with regard to that specific piece of legislation. I would just go back to the answer I gave to Mr. Johnson. It's about their state of readiness in terms of being able to bring them forward, and also ensuring that Parliament has the capacity to consider them. So what I can say is that in line with the agreement, there will be another one in the next parliamentary year. I can't earnestly say that it will definitely be the proposed legislation that Mr. Johnson identifies, though. But I do recognise, as with all of these reports, they are important. We should be making sure that we work our way through them as quickly as possible. That's something the government's committed to doing. If there are other ways of trying to expedite that process further, than I'm all ears and open to considering what they might be.
Great. That's my questions finished. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And Tim Eagle.
A few weeks ago, we were looking at the new climate change bill, the emissions reduction one, and there was quite a lot of debate around the table. One of the issues that we had is that we had a number of questions we wanted to ask, but we couldn't have to get the reply to those questions because of the fast-tracked nature of the bill. So I guess the question is, when you are looking at these bills that are being fast-tracked through, what consideration are you giving to secondary committees like DPLR or the Public and Administrations Committee, Finance and Public Administration Committee, sorry, in terms of how they can effectively scrutinise and debate what is coming through?
Well, I recognise that is important, Mr. Eagle. So it is something that we should seek to accommodate as much as we possibly can. And I guess the first point I would make is, you know, the circumstances by which we would seek to expedite a bill, I would want to minimise. I don't want us to have to bring that forward on the basis of any regularity. It should only be where the circumstances merit it. I think we've laid out, we had a robust debate on the timetabling of the bill last week. And I should say that I hope that we can conclude that process in terms of determining the full timescale. I hope we can conclude that this week. But we should factor in as much as is possible when we're expediting a bill capacity for committees other than the primary committee, to including the DPRC, to be able to undertake its and exercise its functions of scrutiny. I know that there's been engagement with Gillian Martin as the responsible Cabinet Secretary. I believe she's responded. If there are further questions that the committee has, I know she'll be very happy to respond to them again. What I would say in relation to the bill, we have tried to draft it fairly narrowly. It has a narrow purpose. Obviously deals with a very, very important issue, convener, but it is not a wide-ranging bill, and the delegated powers that are within it are, by our estimation, necessary as Climate Change Committee advice is needed to ensure that any new targets set are achievable, and that advice won't be available until spring of next year. So we're trying to grapple with two challenges. First of all, make sure we're not in breach of legal requirements as set out under the existing legislation, but also cognising the fact that we can't look at what the targets should be until subsequently next year. And you know, by our estimation, it makes sense to do that by secondary legislation rather than have to go through the whole process of taking forward primary legislation. At that point, of course, it'll be incumbent for the various committees of Parliament, including this committee, if it so determines, to consider any secondary legislation that emanates from the Climate Change Bill once it is passed.
I guess just going back to that point, though, isn't it, is what, you know, you're right, we've had this debate in the Chamber, but from the purposes of this committee, it's making, I don't think it happens very often, does it, the expedited bills, but I've not been here long enough to know, to be honest, but it's making sure that we can effectively scrutinise that, because there is a concern. You know, we're looking at a legal nature of this secondary legislation, and if we can't effectively do that, get those responses back, consider that with our legal advisers, then is that introducing a risk? So do you think, in hindsight, there is any further discussion you could have had with clerks, with this committee, about how we could make sure we were a part of that process in any future sort of sped-up, rapid build?
Yeah, I mean, the first thing to emphasise, a few other colleagues around the table that are long in the tooth at this as well, expedited bills are very unusual, yeah. And I do not think they should become a feature of our process for making legislation. So just to give you that reassurance, Mr. Eagle, I'm, you know, I guess it goes back to the point I made earlier, I'm always willing for us to learn, to improve and refine the process. And if this committee feels that in the order of taking forward any expedited bill, as much as I don't want us to have to do that very often, that there's something we could do to improve the process to better involve this committee or indeed the Finance Committee, as you've also mentioned, then I'm more than willing to hear what that might be.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So, now, Minister, just to move on to the LCMs, can you provide the committee on the latest position on the upcoming LCMs, in particular any likely to engage the remit of this committee?
Yes, this is primarily going to emanate from the King's speech. So right now we have four legislative consent memoranda lodged, one for the Passenger Railway Services Public Ownership Bill, one for the Great British Energy Bill, one for Renters' Rights Bill, one for the Product Regulation and Metrology Bill. So they are lodged. I should say I recognise that the last one was lodged slightly late. Of course, we are, well, that's driven by how much time in advance notice we as a government will get from the UK government. There are others that we anticipate we'll need to bring forward. At this stage, we don't have any confirmed introduction dates from the UK government for the Tobacco and Vapes Bill, Digital Information and Smart Data Bill, Planning and Infrastructure Bill, Railways Bill, Planning and Infrastructure Bill, the Employment Rights Bill and the Artificial Intelligence Bill. So that's an indication of what's before us, or likely to be before us, and we would go through the usual process, identify the relevant committees, and where that involves this committee, we'd seek to engage the committee as soon as possible.
Okay. No, that's helpful. Thank you. Chairman Buffer.
Following on from that, Minister, I wonder what updates can the Minister provide on discussions that your government had with the UK government on proposals to grant UK ministers delegated powers in devolved areas and the use of consent requirements for such powers. Have these discussions taken into account our position in relation to scrutiny of powers within devolved competence?
I take very seriously the purpose of parliamentary scrutiny in this place. So we would always seek to communicate that to the UK government as well. And primarily that comes down to an issue of timing. I want to make sure that this parliament has as much time as possible to consider these matters so they can be properly scrutinised. We would always seek to achieve that in as much as we possibly can, but given that these, by their nature, emanate from UK government legislation, then some of the timing is out with our hands. So yes, we would always seek to press that point that I suspect it's not just this committee, it'll be all committees of Parliament or generally, that there should be adequate time to scrutinise the powers within devolved competence.
And how are the discussions going with the UK government in regards to that? I know in some ways we try to rise above party politics when it's dealing with these issues. I'm just wondering with the new UK government, what discussions and how your discussions are going with them.
Well, it's early days, so the relationship thus far seems to be productive, but ultimately it will be determined by practical experience. So it's probably a little early to be able to say. I think, to be fair, and I can be fair on occasion to the UK government, of course they were just elected, coming up against the timescale of our summer recess, and they want to hit the ground running and bring forward legislation fairly quickly, and then it comes up against their own timescale, which isn't ideal, but certainly there seems to be an indication of the understanding of our perspective, but proof will be in the pudding.
I just wonder, moving on, is the Minister able to say any more or say anything about the Scottish Government's in principle position on extending SIP 2 beyond non-former EU areas?
I suppose the first point is that I think the committee that's looked at this in some detail is the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. They've obviously published their report in terms of how devolution or the impact of the post-EU, post-Brexit environment is impacting on devolution. We have responded to that report. We have acknowledged, and this kind of goes back to the point I've just made, that we will press these points to the UK government, but we've acknowledged that the Parliament should have the opportunity to effectively scrutinise the exercise of all legislative powers within devolved competence. We share the perspective that's been expressed by the committee. There are practical issues that arise out of the need for the UK government to agree to cooperate in any arrangement with a wider scope than the current protocol. We should remind ourselves, of course, the protocol that exists is between this government and the Scottish Parliament. So the UK government aren't a direct party to the protocol, but how effectively the protocol might work in practice is reliant on how they work in practice. And Angus Robertson is the minister that's leading on this as the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. So So he right now is given consideration as to how we can best advance that with the UK government, and I know he will be happy to update the committee as to how that goes, just as he'll update the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee as well.
And Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Convener. So I'm quite excited, Minister, because we've recently launched our framework bill inquiry into both framework bills and Henry VIII legislation. And so I won't labour it, because I'm looking forward to an extended debate with you in the future months to come. But do you believe that any of the bills announced in the recent programme for government are, would you consider framework bills?
Well, whatever floats your boat, Esther.
I'm very excited.
Well, first of all, in relation to the inquiry, I actually do welcome the inquiry, and we obviously had a private session to discuss some of that a few months ago. I think it will be very helpful that the committee undertakes that inquiry, because there is obviously a narrative around framework bills. There is no definition of what a framework bill actually is, although I think we have some sense of what that might look like. So the committee dedicating some of its time to look into this in more detail, I think, is welcome, and I'll be very happy to participate willingly and equally as excitedly in that process of deliberation. In relation to the current programme for government, bills are still being finalised, so it's difficult for me to answer that question in specific detail. But what I can say is that as soon as we are able to, we'll be able to provide that detail to Parliament, notwithstanding the point I would make is there is no definition of a framework bill, so at this stage, without there being such, I'm unlikely to come forward and say this is a framework bill for you, but I think we will recognise that there is legislation where a fair bit of the detail has still to be worked out through secondary legislation. I would make the point that there is, of course, nothing wrong with us determining the law through secondary legislation. It's a long, well-established part of our process in terms of making the law. I guess the question is, and it's a legitimate question, is the circumstances in which it's appropriate to do so. And we'll always be happy and open to discuss that with Parliament, either on a principle basis, as your inquiry might lend itself to, or when push comes to shove, when any specific bill is debated, and it'll be for Parliament to consider whether or not it considers that to be an appropriate approach.
Thank you very much. I guess you're right, isn't it? What is a framework bill, and to what extent does the Parliament need to have that ability to effectively scrutinise something? What about land reform then, or National Care Service? I mean, those bills are both out in, well, National Care Service not so much, but land reform is out. Do you not consider those framework bills?
I would recognise that in the bills that you've referred to, and I think there's been a very public debate around the National Care Service Bill, that substantial parts of it have to be determined by secondary legislation. Whether or not I consider that a framework bill without any standardised, recognised, agreed definition is another thing.
OK. Land reform?
I would refer you to my last answer.
Okay, fair enough. So, one more question on this then. So, what consideration, like, do you have in government about what might be a framework bill? Like, when you are talking about these things, I guess the question becomes: to what extent do you say actually this is something we want to co-design, to use the political sort of phrasing of it, post and use a lot of secondary legislation, and this is something actually we can be very specific about? I mean, is that talked about quite a lot behind the scenes?
Yeah, there will be considerations. So, you've talked about the co-design process. I think that's quite specific to the approach that was taken with the National Care Service Bill. You know, other circumstances, that won't be the rationale. So let's take the example of Social Security, for instance. It would be, I think we would all agree, ludicrous that if we were to uprate benefits or make slight alterations to qualifying criteria to have to bring forward primary legislation in every instance where these matters can be dealt with through secondary legislation, usually brought forward on an annual basis. So, you know, the circumstances under which we would consider that the utilisation of secondary legislation is the appropriate way forward to make the law will differ depending on the rationale. So the rationale you've cited and is sort of specific to the circumstance of the National Care Service Bill, by contrast to other circumstances where it's a long, well-established part of our processes in terms of uprating benefits or altering registration fees and so on and so forth.
I look forward to our future discussions on this. It'd be interesting.
As do I.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions for the Minister and his team? No? Okay, none. Okay, Minister, I'd like to thank you and your officials for your evidence this morning. The committee may follow up in letter with any additional questions stemming from the session. So with that, thank you very much. And with that now concludes the public part of today's session. Thank you.